Good evening and welcome to the February 15th, 1994 Planning Board meeting of Cape Elizabeth. First order of business, the meetings from the previous meeting, January 18th, 1994. Any comments, corrections, changes? Judy?
Chairman, I just had a question on page 5, first paragraph. Talks about the applicant, Ann Heath, that she would like to build a log home on People's Cove Road. And I didn't remember that the case. I wanted to make sure someone else did. It was log.
I think she mentioned that. It wasn't part of the plan, I don't think, but she, in her discussion, mentioned it was a log home.
Okay, thank you.
I didn't hear that at all.
Anything else?
No.
Do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the minutes be accepted as amended.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any other discussion? All those in, before we take a vote, we're missing one voting member, so I'll appoint Peter as a voting member for the entire evening. All those in favor of the approval of the minutes, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. Next order of business is to review the correspondence. We have quite a list. First is a letter from Bob Marvin, which I said would be in the package from the last meeting, indicating his resignation and some comments dealing with having a board of 7 voting members versus 5 voting members, which on a number of different fronts, different committees and boards are looking into that as quickly as we can. It was a good suggestion. We'll miss Bob and Bob's perspective, I think, on this planning board. Next was a letter from Irving Chapel, town council chairman, to Robert Marvin, indicating that they would be pursuing, at least looking into the issue of all voting members on the planning board. Next were the minutes from the January 13 meeting of the building, Cape Elizabeth School Building Committee, and we've had these, and the first time it came across the podium, I just said, you know, that's very nice of them to keep us up to date and so forth, and they evidently have lots of meetings. It might be worthwhile just to throw these all in an envelope so you can review these when this application comes here, to just to keep yourself, give yourself some historical perspective of what they're going through. Next is the meeting of January 20th of the Cape Elizabeth School Building Committee, and a meeting of January 27th of the Cape Elizabeth School Building Committee, and a meeting of February 3rd, the Cape Elizabeth School Building Committee. It's a lot of reading. Next is the American Planning Association's pamphlet, Environment and Development. It's just dealing with some development of meadowlands in New Jersey and several other small articles. Next, a memo from Bill McGoldrick, fire chief here in Cape Elizabeth, to Maureen, addressing the issue of public access on Highview Road, and I'm trying to remember the applicant's, a Heath?
Yes.
The Heath application. I guess my only comment was, I'm not sure that, I think in the approval, we're asking for some type of letter or memo, and I'm, maybe perhaps later we can bring up whether this satisfies the request of that condition. Next, and I take it this is from Maureen, reviewing an outline reviewing the responsibility of and for boards and commissions, just so everybody can keep that in their packet. On the podium tonight, further communication, there's a construction environmental protection seminar February 23rd, and I'm going to be away, and it's one of the few types of topics that I actually enjoy. There are some interesting panel people. I think perhaps if somebody's interested in going, contact you, Maureen. Very good. Next, from the Natural Resource Council of Maine, as I have mentioned in prior months, the plumbing code is back again. The DHS is proposing to reduce the 15 inches of soil previously required in order to site a septic system to 12 inches and 10 inches everywhere else. I won't sermonize on this. Interesting reading. Should take a look at it. Next, Traveling Smart, which is also a brochure, I think. Yes, Natural Resource Council of Maine. Some planning issues dealing with traffic. And lastly, I asked Maureen to photocopy the pertinent parts of this letter from the Department of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife, which came to myself and Maureen and I think Ernie McVeigh. The second page, I think it's the second page of everyone's, is a reduced map, and we have the original. We have three different originals of maps, I think. If you're more interested, we, of course, it should be part of our planning process, showing the, I think it's potential, nope. The actual nesting, foraging, and brood rearing areas of piping plover in the least terns. There has been already one public hearing, I think it's held in Brunswick. You might note that from south end of Crescent Beach all the way to the mouth of the Spurring River in Cape Elizabeth is an area designated as such, except for a very small area, which we recently reviewed as Ram Island subdivision, which is an outpiece from that proposed protected area. I think we should keep this in our packet and incorporate it in our review. This type of thing will come up in our board goals, I think, later on in this meeting. Any other correspondence, letters, concerns to bring to the planning board? Very good. I think the first order of old business this evening is the Drynan public access waiver request by Edward Drynan for a public access waiver. Three lots located in the vicinity of 367 Mitchell Road. Public hearing, section 19.4.2b. I think what we will do, Mr. Drynan, is if you could just briefly update the board and the public changes that have been made since you were last here. Then we'll take a little bit of time for a public hearing and then ask you to come back to answer any concerns or we'll continue the discussion.
Fine. Based upon last month's meeting and this your board sidewalk, some changes were made. They're reflected in the plan before you. They center mostly upon the fire station, on the certain specifications of the driveway, and a couple of minor changes which were incorporated into the plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Drennan. I think at this time I will open this article on the agenda for a public hearing. Basic guidelines or rules of a public hearing are to come to the podium, address the board, introduce yourself and your residence, list where you reside, and make whatever public comment you wish to, trying to keep it any comments to the application at hand. If there are more than one speaker, try not to repeat exact items of concern. I guess that's about it. Are there any members of the public which would like to speak? Chris?
My name is Christopher Newell. My wife and I own 359 Mitchell Road, which I think on your plan, Mr. Drynan presented to you last month, is the location of the former Harriman farm. And interestingly enough, I did not want to speak too much about his plan, however, to speak to one of the points, however, that was tagged, and that is the tree removal. If you come down the street on Mitchell Road, you'll note that many trees have been tagged as part of this plan. And my simple statement was that if you drive Mitchell Road, you know there are an awful lot of trees already there. These trees that are due to be removed abut my property, though they would not ruin any particular view. I found it a little nonsensical to suggest that these trees should go. And that, frankly, was the only comment I had on this. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Any other members of the public wish to speak? Seeing and hearing none, I'll close the public hearing and open it back up for discussion. Ask the applicant to come back to the podium and open it to the board for further discussion. Any comments, questions of the applicant? Tom?
Excuse me, I apologize for missing the sidewalk. I recall that the next Monday morning, as I was driving down Route 77, and I went past Mitchell Road. For some reason, I thought about turning left, and then I realized I'd missed the sidewalk.
Actually, Tom, you looked at the thermometer, and you saw how cold it was, and you rolled over and down.
One question regarding the revised plan, and that is the gravel turnaround area. Is that anticipated to be exclusive for the use of turning around for emergency vehicles, or in the event that Lot 3 is developed, would that become, in fact, part of the driveway to Lot 3?
I don't know. It depends on where we locate the driveway. Right now, it's designed, that's the sole recommendation of the fire chief, who wanted it there, and he wanted it that size and that location.
I guess I'll just ask if my recollection is the same as I'll ask the board if my recollection is that in similar situations, the town has not wanted to have dead-end turnarounds used as driveways because of conflicts between private and public use and the issue of maintenance.
That's true.
I don't understand what the maintenance issue is, since the maintenance issue is covered in the deed covenants for the properties involved. They're all responsible for maintaining all the property within the right-of-way in which that turnaround is placed.
I guess what I would say is that unless the fire chief and police chief indicate otherwise, it would be my understanding that this turnaround could not be used and extended as part of a driveway, but would have to remain for the exclusive use for the turnaround of emergency vehicles. An example would be if you had a reception or some large gathering at Lot 3 and the driveway was full of vehicles, and we've had other examples, and this recently was brought up with a subdivision on the other side, well, not too far down Mitchell Road, just off Mitchell Road. So I don't have any problem with the layout. I would only encourage, and again, I've been to the site, but I wasn't at the sidewalk, that as few trees as reasonable be removed in order to preserve the character of Mitchell Road, but also keeping in mind the public safety issues. Thank you.
Thanks. Mr. Drani, in your notes, you mentioned that you suggest removing only the oak brush and cluster. Is that the little cluster of brush right beside the driveway?
Yes.
Okay. I echo the concerns, and the public member that spoke, the road edge effect of all of those trees that and we appreciate you tagging them to give us some indication of what might be. I have a concern also that those are on town-owned land and requiring the applicant to remove the town's trees. If the town wants them removed, I suppose they can be removed. I'd like to see them, and I'm looking for some consensus, I guess, also from the board. Other comments from board members? Judy?
I have several. First, some questions and comments on the plans. On the entrance access detail, it's my understanding that there's supposed to be an 18-foot wide paved or graveled road, but if you look at a note that says if paving is continued beyond 50 feet, pavement to be 10 feet wide with 1 foot wide gravel shoulder each side, which would drop the roadway to 12 feet. I didn't think that was the intention.
The fire chief made it pretty clear, and in fact, members of this board said so at its workshop on December 7th, that even if a wider gravel driveway than what I had in place was in fact what the result of this hearing was, that gravel could be grassed over so that the traveled way visually would be 10 or 12 feet wide.
Notes that I have from our last meeting, this was a suggestion Mr. Emery made, was for instance a 12-foot wide travel lane, which could be, I think you intended, gravel, with the remaining 3 foot per side shoulders grassed, which is a substantial difference. We're still talking about an 18-foot road bed, whether you see it, perceive it as 18 feet or 12 feet, as opposed to the 12 feet you're proposing. I'm curious if other board members find that acceptable. It doesn't seem like the fire chief would accept a 12-foot width. Do you know, Maureen?
Excuse me, I spoke with the fire chief, I believe it was Thursday, and he had reviewed this plan and told me that it was exactly what he had asked the applicant to prepare.
Do you know if he caught that note? Because it differs from other notes elsewhere specifying the width of the roadway.
My understanding is he wanted it to be 18 feet from the entrance from Mitchell Road up until just past the turnaround, and from there on, he was happy with 12 feet.
I think that needs to be clarified on the plan.
If you could just wait a minute while I review that note, could you tell me where that is?
Yes, look on your entrance access detail, which is at the very bottom. There, yeah, midway, right there.
Right. If it is ever paved beyond the 50 feet, it will be up to the three people who live there to do so. And are you saying, so that I understand, that if it is paved, 10 feet is unacceptable to you? You wanted 18 feet paved?
It was my understanding that the bottom line was that there should be 18 feet of a strong load-bearing surface that could carry emergency vehicles. Now, I think, Mr. Emery, correct me if I'm wrong, I think you suggested a visual roadway, if you will, 10 to 12 feet with shoulders on either side that could be grassed over.
That's correct. That's correct, and it appears from the section at the top of the page that they're indicating an 18-foot wide gravel area. And then the shoulder, I guess, would be dictated by the note on the plans. In my experience, fire chiefs always want an 18-foot wide fire lane. The reality, and that's usually so they can get their stabilizing, whatever they're called, things down. But the actual travel width can be narrower than that when you think that the vehicles travel on a standard town or state road, which typically has a 12-foot wide lane. I think if you have an 18-foot wide gravel base and the road ends up being 10 to 12 feet wide, that's certainly reasonable.
That's my impression also. As long as at all times of the year, the chief, the concern that I understood from him was not so much parking on the traveled way, on the roadway, but two vehicles passing one another. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't care if he's driving over grass or not, as long as he doesn't sink under it.
Yeah.
I guess my only concern then is if that's your intention with that note, just to clarify it, I guess the first way I read it was that the extent of the gravel would be reduced to 12 feet as opposed to 18 feet.
That's incorrect.
Okay. That could be clarified then. Thank you. Another thing, I'm still quite disappointed that we have no vegetation on the plan or the site distances that the engineer had requested, because if site distances are dependent on having some sort of clearing, and I agree with other people here, it certainly doesn't have to be all the trees that were tagged, but without having the vegetation located on the plan, especially the vegetation that's proposed to be removed, I don't know how, as a board, we can feel like any particular vegetation will be removed, because there is nothing on the plan. And I still would strongly recommend that we have, I think it was the engineer's comment that vegetation within, or maybe it was significant vegetation within 300 feet of the entrance be marked on the plan, that vegetation to be removed would be indicated as such, and that he also suggested that the tree warden's approval is necessary since it is within the town's right-of-way. But I made that comment last time. It's not a new one. I think those are my only comments for right now.
Any other comments? Mark?
No.
Peter?
Nothing.
I have a comment, and it comes from the HHE 200, there's an addendum to that, and then we're seeing it, and I actually don't know whether it's state plumbing code or not, or I've seen it worded several different ways. Number two lists, if you have a garbage disposal in your home, you should install a dual compartment septic tank or install a filter on the outlet, such as a Zabel Industries model A100 or equal. In the past, I've made an issue of the septic system where they are sited. I think the likelihood of any contemporary home having a garbage disposal in the residence is very high. And I would like to see it as a part of the plan itself, that it requires dual septic tanks. There's a real reason why that's required. I've gone over it before at another public meeting. The reason that that's required is that without it, the solids are macerated by the disposal, so that the solids actually get to the chamber system itself and cause it to fail. As just one board member, I'd like to see that one requirement is a part of the plan for those sites requiring septic systems, that they require two septic tanks or a Zabel filter. I'll just make the comment that I believe Al Frick, who also does a lot of work on applications in this town, his statement says that they must install. That's the extent of my comments. Any other comments, questions?
Was there any board discussion on the fact that the proposed septic is not in the building envelope, which is, it's typically our practice, but there is no requirement for such in the public access waiver standards?
I have no other comment. It has been an issue, and I mentioned it before, that I felt that the location where it shows on the plan of the proposed sites is not neighborly. Mr. Drynan, the applicant, says that may not be where they end up because there are plenty of sites on site that are more practical. And after looking at the sites, I tend to agree with them. That may happen. I have backed off from that stand. If that were the only place on those lots where those could be placed, I'd be more concerned. I think the requirement for having a dual septic tank or a Zabel filter at least ensures some longevity to a chamber system or high capacity infiltration system. Other comments? Mark?
I have a question about the septic system for lot 3 in particular. Was the reason that it was put in the corner so remote from the building envelope because there are unsuitable soils on lot 3 or near the building envelope, or
I'd be happy to answer that question. Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't think you're at the workshop nor the sidewalk when the explanations were given for those.
Yes, I apologize for missing the sidewalk, but...
And the workshop.
I was in the workshop.
At the workshop, on December 7th, I explained and I presented soils tests which covered random areas all over this site. The soils engineer, Mr. Camilla, was with me that night, and he explained that in the intervening years, the condition of the soils had not changed, and that in his opinion, soils throughout the site were suitable for septic systems. And I pointed out that I thought it was an unnecessary time and expense for me to go through to do new test pits to demonstrate soils adequacy. So the board wanted that done. In addition, the board not only wanted that done, but it wanted the actual septic system design furnished. I pointed out at the workshop on December 7th. I pointed out at the meeting in January. I pointed out at the sidewalk in January, and I'll do it again now. Soils throughout are adequate. The reason the septic systems were redone and designed and submitted was solely to satisfy the wishes of some members of this board. Whoever builds a house here, in all likelihood, will go through the same exercise again and locate the septic systems in a location which is conducive to house size, house design, house orientation, driveway location, landscaping, etc. I don't intend that anybody thinks that, I don't think they're going to use that place over there. I think they're going to do something over here. But I was merely satisfying these requirements of you people.
Any other comments? Questions? Do I hear a motion? Tom?
Findings of facts, motion for the findings of facts. Number one, Edward Drynan is requesting a public access waiver for three lots located at 367 Mitchell Road, which require review under section 19-4-2B. The plan substantially complies with the requirements of section 19-4-2B public access waiver. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Ed Drynan for public access waiver for three lots located at 367 Mitchell Road be granted, subject to the following condition. Condition number one. On the plan that the entrance detail, that the note, if paving is continued beyond 50 feet, pavement width to be 10 feet wide with 2 foot wide gravel shoulders each side, saying that the gravel will be 18 feet. That the clearing of trees for site distances be reviewed and approved by the town arborist and the police chief. And thirdly, that the appropriate septic systems be required for the house that's proposed for the site.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? Judy?
I think two suggestions to Mr. Emery for his consideration. There is comments in there from the town engineer recommending that a note be added to the plan to limit the maximum grade of the first 50 feet of that private road to 5%. The standard is 2%. The engineer would accept 5%, but no more, and the application somewhere states that it's plus or minus 5%. Secondly, there might be a condition indicating that there will be no driveway access through the proposed gravel turnaround. Having said that, I still feel extremely comfortable delegating the authority of what trees shall be removed to the police chief and the arborist, Mr. Emery called him, given that the police have already recommended that all those trees come down. So I can't vote for this motion.
I guess it was unclear to me which ones you were recommending as amendments to that.
That the first 50 feet of this private roadway, that the grade of that first 50 feet be less than or equal to 5%.
Not to be greater than.
And okay. The second comment was that it be made clear on the plans that a driveway access is not allowed through the gravel turnaround, because I believe that is our code.
Mr. Emery, are those suggestions acceptable as amendments?
Yes, they are.
Okay. And to the person second?
Yes, they are.
Peter? Okay. Reviewed by... Any other comments? My only comment, Tom, in your motion is that I'm not sure that you said that the appropriate septic systems require.
I guess I don't want to state specifically that we're going to require two septic tanks if indeed someone elects not to have a disposal. Admittedly, that presents problems when people go to sell their properties, but on the other hand, if someone wants to trash out their disposal system in a short period of time and pay to rebuild it, I think, as long as they're aware of the impacts that that causes, and presumably we're dealing with responsible contractors and buyers that are aware of that situation. In my opinion, it detracts, I mean, I've heard the same argument, people that don't want to put in a separate system for washing machines. I think the more restrictive the system is in terms of flexibility of the use of the house, the less marketable the house is. So I guess I'll leave it that the market forces will determine what size septic system will be installed. I'm just simply saying that for whatever, if the applicant ends up building the houses and elects to install, or a plumbing contractor elects to install garbage disposals, then they should be, the septic system should be designed accordingly.
Are you not at all concerned about the possibility of the second homeowner coming in and just hiring a plumber to put in a Sears garbage disposal unknowingly? You think that won't happen?
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
It's easier to do it yourself.
Well,
I was at the lumber yard this weekend, and I think there ought to be a license for home improvement for everyone from what the stuff I saw going out the door, but that's another matter.
Any other comments? Questions? Can I just have a perhaps Maureen, if you feel comfortable going down through, reiterating what were the initial conditions? I think the beginning needs to be read. And those amendments to that that were acceptable.
Okay, with warning that I may not have number three quite right, but starting with the first one, that on the plan, the entrance detail note be changed to require 4-foot wide shoulders on each side of the road, and that would give you an 18-foot wide traveled surface. Number two, that the town arborist and the police chief approve any proposed tree removal. Number three, that you wanted a review of septic systems for any houses proposed on the site. Number four, that the grade of the first 50 feet of the proposed driveway be no greater than 5%. And number five, that there be no driveway access through the proposed gravel turnaround.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Tom.
In retrospect, I think note three can be stricken. We have a code enforcement officer whose responsibility it is to review the plans and review building permit applications, and he will review the HHE 200 forms along with the building plans. I mean,
okay,
anyone building a house in this community has to abide by state plumbing laws, and that's the same law that the code enforcement officer is going to use in reviewing the application for a building permit.
In number three, what was number three reading?
Number three was that appropriate septic system would be installed for the particular house that's proposed. I don't think that note needs to be as a condition anymore.
As I said my comment, I'm not sure that there's plumbing code that they shall or should. Twin tanks should be required, so, and I'm not sure that it is. Maybe David, is it part of code?
It isn't part of code as a requirement, it's a recommendation.
The board should keep in mind the town also has a sewage ordinance, which is in many cases more restrictive than the state plumbing code. So it still may be a requirement. I can't tell you whether it is or
it doesn't address that issue. Peter, did you have a comment?
No.
Did you? Is that what you said?
He's asking to have number three removed. He seconded.
Okay, right. It's been asked to be stricken number three. Is that acceptable to you?
Yes, it is.
Seconding the motion. Okay.
Mr. Edsel?
Yes, Drew.
Just one more comment on the comment about tree removal. I think in the proposed motion, it's not at all apparent whether the planning board has no opinions on how many trees should be removed, or if all of them should be removed as recommended by the police department, or none of them should be removed. I don't know if you would want to state anything in that motion.
I would concur with you, and maybe Tom can respond to both of us, is that the way that I understood Tom's comment was that these trees aren't on the subject site plan approval, and that it's not part of this plan, if for some, any, for some reason they should be removed, then that would be up to the police chief and the arborist. Maybe that, is that not...
That's correct.
The only reason I'm harping on this is one of the, I mean, we don't have that many standards, it seems to me, to look at when we're doing public access waivers, but site distance is a definite one. And if the only memo we have is to achieve adequate site distance is remove quite a few of the trees, I wonder if we are kind of giving up our authority here and our responsibility.
Well, there again, I think it's a public safety issue, and if someone is, if this were a single-family driveway, the trees could exist and there wouldn't be a problem. Now that we have three lots, we assume that two other people are going to be negligent. In any event, it comes down in our laps that it's our responsibility to determine what's public, what's safe for the public and what isn't. I think this is strictly an issue, it's an issue of, obviously, of community concern with the rural character of Mitchell Road, but ultimately, because of the new driveway location, I think it's also the responsibility of the police chief to deal with the public safety issue, which I think can only be determined on-site and carefully marking the trees individually as you look down the road, and then obviously having the arborist there to determine that the appropriate trees are being removed. I think we have two good sources to deal with that issue simultaneously.
I guess my question is then, should we be more specific in your motion or the condition that it, although not a condition of the plan, any removal of trees in the right-of-way should be, then it's a moot point. Why bring it into the site plan?
Excuse me, why bring in what?
Why bring it in as a condition of the site plan if it's not really a condition of this site plan approval? It's an off-site, I suppose we bring it as an off-site requirement?
Well, I was doing it under the assumption that it would help to minimize the number of trees that are actually going to be removed.
Mm.
Judy, I think, seems to think differently.
Well, I think leaving it out there and making it an issue draws the attention of the police chief who's reviews the record of the planning board and other than the tape recording, indicates that they think the site distance needs to be improved, so they recommend taking those trees out. It was only subsequent to that memo that the discussion here was that those trees don't seem to be on the site anywhere. They are in the right-of-way of the town.
Judy just showed me, reminded me with that memo, that it says that they only need to be reviewed if the planning board insists. I guess the question is the planning board insisting? As long as no one's going to sue the planning board because they chose not to drive carefully or exit carefully under existing conditions, I would not insist that anything be removed.
Okay, I guess and I don't want to dwell on this, but it is an issue that needs to be, I think, clearly stated, either removed as a condition or simply stated that the planning board does not insist.
In response to the police chief's memo, I'd clarify note number two stating that the planning board does not insist that the trees mentioned in the chief's memo need to be removed.
Peter, is that acceptable to you?
Acceptable.
Okay. I think that just makes it more clear, the intent of that condition. Anything further? So that's perfectly clear to everybody. Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. All those opposed? Was that, Mark, did you vote in favor? Okay. It's 4-1. You're allowed in opposition. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Good site plan approval. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thanks. Next order of business this evening is under old business. Cumberland Farms site plan request by the Cumberland Farms for site plan review of a canopy addition at their store located at 278 Ocean House Road. Site plan complete in this section 19-2-10. Good evening. The applicant to introduce yourself and bring us up to date as to changes made to the plan since our last meeting.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. My name is Tom Greer from Hickman Greer. We're the engineers for the project. We've been brought on to the project after the last planning board meeting, so I'm, if If I haven't hit all of the history that you know, hopefully I will bring you up to date with what we've done since we were brought on board. We had a meeting with Maureen to review what the board's concerns were as of the December meeting, and as a result have submitted the revised plan that you see. Since the last meeting, we've gone out and done some survey work in the yard area, this being the existing building here. What's shown here in orange is the proposed canopy. That survey work was aimed mostly at trying to make sure that the grading plan that got put together was done correctly and that we had actual grades of the site. There was some concern as to exactly how the grading would be done. At the same time, we located a number of site features simply so that we could locate the grading in the correct place and make sure that what was originally submitted was correct. As a result of that, there was a few discrepancies in the plans, and we have revised some of the locations. The sidewalk is probably the issue that is of most concern to the board. The original site plan showed the sidewalk coming around and ending approximately here. What it actually does is extend another 40 or 50 feet along Scott Dyer Road and ends in this location. There is still a short section of that esplanade that does not have sidewalk constructed along it. At the same time that it was pointed out that the trees along that edge were of concern, the survey crew located the four trees that are of concern with respect to the sidewalk. There's actually a fifth tree along here that's back along parallel to the sidewalk that would not be disturbed. So there's that minor discrepancy. At the same time, we took a look at the ordinance and the concerns with the town center plan and making sure that this plan, if it could come into compliance with that we did. The additions to the plans that we have made is that we've added three street trees along this side of Route 77 so that there would be a break between the sidewalk and the travel way with a street tree. Again, that is to provide comfort for pedestrians who walk along Route 77, that if you have something between you and the traffic, even if it's not continuous, you feel more comfortable, and I think that was what we had gleaned out of the town center plan as being required. The other issues that are still outstanding that we think we have addressed, but again, open for discussion. There are two lights that light this end of the parking lot that were approved as part of the 1984 site plan that are existing. One of the poles has been damaged. I believe the luminaire is still working and that there is adequate light across the end here. What we have not done is prepared an illumination level, photometric level plan for it that I guess our feeling was is that was approved in 84. It appears to be adequate. What we have shown is the photometrics for what goes underneath the canopy and the lighting under that. Again, our understanding is that lighting level may or may not be acceptable to the planning board, not in terms of being bright enough, but in actuality being too bright. What we would like to do is, if it's acceptable to the board, is to put the condition on it, on any approvals that would be work with Cumberland Farms is more than willing to work with the town. If the lighting levels need to be reduced, then removing fixtures and that type of thing is acceptable to them for that condition. And I think we can arrive at a safe lighting level as well as one that's not too bright. The other thing that we have added to the package that was a concern of the last time was in the application itself, we have provided photographs of the front of the site, and these are not shown very well on TV, but the board has copies of these that show two different canopies. And what we're asking the board to do is to look at each one of the canopies and really make a motion that would say, which canopy do you like? Cumberland Farms has supplied canopy one, which would be two posts that would hold a pitched roof on it, and on the pitched roof would be asphalt shingles. The asphalt shingles would essentially match the existing building, so you'd have a tie in architectural styles at that location. The second canopy is more of a traditional canopy, very similar to the one across the street. where you have a plastic, 3-foot plastic facade edge on it that would be blue, that would provide some advertising space for golf, a very small sign for that. That is the canopy of choice for Cumberland Farms. Obviously, we're giving the board the option. We prefer that one in that it is a very clear signal to customers that you're dealing with a Cumberland Farms store. They know that it's a fuel island. It has an advertising draw. It's standard in the industry, so to speak. The canopies themselves are required to protect and essentially hide some of the fire suppression systems. Where these are self-service pumps, then a fire suppression service system is required, and those are within the canopy structure itself. That those are required, the fire suppression systems are required by state law. They can be left unexposed, but that's not normally done for maintenance and aesthetics reasons. The only other item, two other items that we have also addressed is over here on the far end of the store. There are now two dumpsters. One of them is actually a recycling container for cardboard. The fencing around those will be redone. Currently it sits out in the open, very visual as you drive by. They will be redoing the fences in that area and putting it back in the enclosure. And the other item was, in this particular area, there are some handicapped spaces in order to meet ADA standards. The paving in this particular area will be redone so that you have a slope of less than 5% so that you can access the store, for instance, by a wheelchair up over the slope and around and on a flat surface, so that that would meet those requirements. I think, in summary, those are the issues that the board has raised in the past. And I think we've addressed them in ways, hopefully, that are acceptable to the board.
Very good. Thank you very much. I remind the planning board that the first issue before us is to deem this application either complete or incomplete. The one that was here before, it was deemed incomplete. There were certain items that the planning board suggested or requested that be added to bring it to completeness. I think, not going down through our typical checklist with Maureen, I think I'll just open it up for discussion first, and I want to make sure that the board knows and stays to the issue of completeness, whether this application, regardless of its qualitative nature, whether the items are complete, and that we don't start to get involved in the merit of the technical merit of the application itself. Open for discussion. Judy?
Looking down at the checklist, I only see three items that are indicated as partially complete. The road information, which is apparently has to do with measurement of site distance and traffic generation information. 12B, location design of sanitary waste disposal systems, and 14, lighting details and foot candle radius. And view that those are partially addressed. With the roadway information, it's not a question of whether that's been provided. It seems to be a question of whether more is necessary. That seems to me it would address the completeness standard. With respect to the sanitary waste disposal systems, the plans do show the existing septic tank and the existing absorption trench, which the old plans did, and in the last checklist that was marked as being complete. So for those reasons, I would say that item is met from a completeness standpoint. And with respect to number 14, the lighting details, they have provided the photometric information on all new lights, and while I would like to see information on the existing lights, I would not want to hold them up for completeness because of that. So I would say this is complete.
Mm-hmm. Any other comment? Thomas? Mark? Peter? I agree, Judy, with your commentary. I think in dealing with issues of completeness, an item is there, it is there, the quality or how substantial it is not the question that we're dealing with. It's a question of whether the item's there to start the review process. Any other questions, comments? I think the first issue that we take up is whether the application is complete, then we go on to make a decision whether we want to hold a public hearing, and then we continue with discussion on the plan. I guess the first step, if there's no other discussion, I'd like to hear a motion. Tom?
Before there is a motion, I just have one comment. I want to be absolutely sure that the applicant understands that if we do find it, the application complete, it doesn't mean that you bring the same materials back to us at the public hearing and then everything is, I think a lot of people have that misunderstanding, and we've been criticized in the past for not being specific enough about what it is that we need. I'm willing to vote in favor of completeness as long as the applicant understands that although they've provided information that we've asked for, I don't think that they fairly represent the information that it would exist. I'm talking primarily about the photo montage, and I'll get to that after we vote on completeness.
Yeah. You understand what?
I understand.
Okay, good. Do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Goody.
Propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Cumberland Farms for site plan review of a canopy addition be deemed complete.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's deemed complete. At this point in time, I think I'd like to see some discussion from the board, some consensus, whether we hold a public hearing. My notes show that that's not required, but there are certainly times when we do hold a public hearing. Any consensus of the board whether we'd like to have a public hearing?
Yes.
I would very much favor a public hearing.
Seems to be a consensus of scheduling a public hearing. Can I hear a motion then? If you let your eyes drift down from the prior motion. Judy?
Chairman, be it further ordered that the application be tabled. Oops. Actually, I want to take that back because I'm not sure that I want to propose that it be tabled right now.
No, that's right. I'm sorry. I was mistaken. Thank you. About a public hearing.
I would favor a public hearing, but I don't know.
Just make a motion dealing with a public hearing itself, and then we'll deal with the.
Okay, then that the that a public hearing shall be held at the regular March 15th, 1994 meeting of the Planning Board.
Okay. There's a phrase in there I didn't see myself. It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Been moved and second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, unanimous vote for public hearing next month. Now, I think it's most prudent if we're going to be returning for a public hearing. There are issues, evidently, with board members, and I think it's only prudent of us and helpful to the applicant if we can let you know exactly and as precisely as we can what we're actually looking for and any comments that that we can provide you. Who would like to start?
Go ahead, Judy.
From the right bank?
I have a lot of comments and questions here. First, I guess, to Mr. Greer, you've reconfigured or redrawn the location of the canopy, and the way it appears on the plans now, there would be no access lane or travel lane between where the cars on the westernmost island would park and the front walk, if you will, of the store. And I want to know why that is and if that actually makes sense from a circulation point of view.
We were looking at that issue. It was our interpretation that we had a 50-foot setback and that in order to meet that requirement that we needed to be that far back. It also addresses some of the comments in going through the previous traffic reports for Cumberland Farms of having pedestrians that go from fueling pumps to the store to pay and to purchase other items crossing a travel lane. My understanding is that's normal, accepted traffic, both from a pedestrian point of view and from a vehicular point of view, that people who frequent stores anticipate crossing a travel lane. So it's not a real high concern, but it is a concern that was raised. So that addressed that issue.
So you think that there is no conflict of people coming, say, out of parking spaces 3 or 4, backing out and trying to maneuver, how they would have to back out and how far to swing around that island?
Depends on which way they go. Obviously, if they're going out on Scott Dyer Road, then they need to come out and turn around and go around this way. My suspicion is that most of them will go around the island if there are cars there fueling. If not, they will go through the fuel island. But I think there's adequate room for them to back out and turn around.
Okay, I assume our town engineer did look at this particular set of plans.
Yes.
Judy, just interrupt.
Sure.
I don't recall that it did change. In the earlier plan, I was surprised to see that the island was as close to the curb and that it was a tight fit for a car, that the canopy may have shifted.
It did change.
Oh, you're right.
There is
20
a,
feet.
There was a 10-foot wide travel aisle that went through there as well.
Okay. See if I can figure out which of these are appropriate to talk about right now. The engineer had made several comments. I didn't highlight them, referencing a lot of the discrepancies in the plans, and I assume that's something you will fix if there are true discrepancies. I'm not sure what he was speaking to.
Yes, most of the discrepancies that he's referring to are simply a case of we have revised data, and the data that's shown here is correct. For instance, the location of the fuel tanks.
That was a prominent one.
They are existing fuel tanks. They're already in the ground. They're in the location that when they did the survey, they located the fuel access points. And to the best of our knowledge, they're as shown on this drawing. They are not being replaced as part of this project. This project is dealing only with canopies. There'll be new fuel pumps and new piping to the tanks.
Mm-hmm.
But the tanks were brand new in, I believe, 1984, so that they still have some life expectancy.
Okay, the engineer also made comments with respect to the information that was submitted as a traffic report, commenting that that was not a complete report, also that the report was 10 years old. I'd like to hear your comment on that.
What we did was we took a look at the number of vehicles that were coming to the station at this point in time, the number of customers. And as part of the previous approval of Cumberland Farms, there was a traffic report done by TY Land back in 1984, and that predicted a traffic count of 570 or so vehicle ends. Right now they are averaging less than 500, so that with that traffic data in hand, we are still less than the projected traffic that was in 1984.
Was there any counts done with respect to the traffic that is on Scott Dyer Shore and 77 and whatever that intersection is rated, if that has changed in the last 10 years?
I'm sure that from 1984 to now that the number of vehicles on both Ocean House Road and Scott Dyer Road has increased. What's interesting to note through the literature and going through the thing, that the actual number of vehicles on those roads does not significantly change with adding fueling stations. The vehicles that use the pumps are already traveling on Scott Dyer Road and on Route 77. There is very little increase in traffic from that aspect of it. People don't make special trips to go buy fuel. They buy fuel as part of a secondary trip. The convenience store is not being changed. Those trips are already on the road system now going to that thing. So in looking at traffic, the only thing that may change is the actual number of vehicles coming in and out of the existing entrances. And those were approved and have operated very well since 1984. Those are not being changed or modified as a result of the site plan. So that we felt that at this point, with the existing traffic report in hand, the lack of modifications to the site entrances, and that we aren't generating a significant amount of new trips, that additional traffic studies really weren't warranted.
Yeah, I don't know in general how comfortable I feel with one 10 years old, but I would certainly listen to what other board members have to say. I guess maybe two other questions or comments. Wonder if the board might want to consider, and the applicant consider, whether it might be appropriate to continue street trees in the Esplanade or to the west of the sidewalk that is north of the entrance from Route 77. Something to throw out. And the other thing, if you could explain to me, Mr. Greer, on the...
Can I come back to that one?
Sure.
You mean in this area down here?
Yes.
This is already significantly treed from the existing vegetation that's there.
So having the separate wooded area and then an area that is possibly differentiated from the wooden area on here, there is no real difference.
That's right. In other words, the trees come out fairly close to the... Well, there's a power line that comes through here already. This section of Route 77, the sidewalk is actually out against the curb, which is in conflict with the town center plan, but, you know, is already existing in there.
And you're saying the vegetation comes awfully close to the sidewalk?
Yes, this is all fairly heavily wooded in this area. So,
I guess last question I have then is on your proposed canopy number one plans. Two questions. Is it proposed to be 14 or 14 and a half feet high because of some clearance requirements?
Yes, you need to be that high in order to get tractor-trailer vehicles. That's really the height limit on bridges and that type of thing.
Okay, and then the other question is, it's very straightforward to me, what is supporting the canopy number two, but on canopy number one, the description of the posts talk about, for instance, 12 by 12 by quarter inch, I assume, 12 by 12 by 5 16 inch, 8 by 12 by quarter inch. Is that some sort of casing that is around a metal column? Because I don't understand those dimensions.
It's tube steel.
Yeah, those are tube steel. Those are structural steel. There's a structural steel support system. And
so they are square and they're that thickness, the quarter inch or the 5 16th inch thick. Thank you very much.
Any other questions?
I think that's it for me now. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? All right.
Yes, I had a few questions that I'd like to address to Mr. Greer. Is there indeed a 40-foot setback or a 50-foot setback along Route 77 at that point? Because I believe currently it's at 40 feet.
Then I may have misinterpreted the zoning ordinance. When I read through it, it was 50, which is why we adjusted it.
It's 40 feet.
It's 40 feet.
Mm-hmm. 40 feet. Is there any concern from the applicant that out of four aisles for fueling, only three are covered by the canopy? It seemed to be that way because of the travel lane that was there before between the canopy and the building, but now...
If you could just introduce yourself for the record.
My name is Jeffrey Cutting, and I'm the regional manager for Cumberland Farms for the state of Maine. And it's not a real concern to us because basically the canopy affords protection to customers in inclement weather. That side right there could be used on any sunny day or any day where there's not snow or rain coming down. During the other times, the canopy would protect the customers on the inward side of that island so that they would not get wet. So it's not a real problem one way or the other to us. You know, it's normally nice to have something that's concentric over the top, but because of the setback requirements involved, that's the way we decided to do it.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else, Mark?
My other area of concern that I noticed was just in terms of the lighting level and the impact. That's a concern that Mr. Greer noted that I share.
Okay, is the my proposed solution, I guess, acceptable to the board? I guess that's what we would like to get some guidance on.
I would rather see some sort of a proposal from you. I'm not a lighting engineer, but there's a larger canopy across the street that has fewer lights, and it's very bright right now.
It isn't, but part of a condition of that approval across the street was that if the town chooses to go back to that, they can renegotiate the wattage level of those lights. So it's always That's my recollection of that approval is that we approved a certain level of wattage and with the option of going back to the applicant and saying, no, that's too bright, down, and we set a bottom level, which was acceptable in order to find a dime if you dropped it on the ground, I guess, but I think that's what you're looking for. I think if
there's
some type of condition that we can put in there, stating that the as a condition of the application, we can come back to Cumberland Farms and say, let's drop it to the low level of that range that we said that was acceptable.
I guess I have real mixed feelings regarding that. I don't want to get into substantive review. I think one of the reasons the canopies are 14 feet high is because of advertising. The taller the canopy, the more visibility it has. The opportunity for a trailer truck to go underneath one of these canopies, I would think, is extremely rare unless there's a fueling truck. And those fueling trucks tend to be lower than, this doesn't dispense diesel fuel. So I think from that standpoint, that's the reason the canopy is 14 feet in the air. And when the light levels that are proposed, I guess I'd like to hear from the applicant why the light levels are as they're proposed. I think it's very difficult for the town to go up to Jonesy's or to go back to Cumberland Farms and say, these lights are just too bright. I'm not sure how that process is initiated. And again, I know what's going on here. You're in the business of selling gasoline, and I'm not, I just want you to understand that the planning board has, not the planning board, I have some concerns about the way in which it's advertised. So I would like to see from you, I think the light levels that you're talking about literally are task lighting levels for interior uses. They're incredibly high light levels. They're not unusual in the industry, I recognize that, but I still think they're higher than what we need in the town center.
We'll do that as part of the submittal back to the board in addressing that in more detail.
Good. The comment that I have to make, and it started to allude to it, back to the photo montage, and I appreciate that was a request that we see that and that there are times when it's very effective, and one of those where it's quite effective. It does appear, however, that this montage, and I'm looking at proposed canopy number one,
yes,
does not reflect the 10-foot, having moved that in 10 feet toward the cement. I mean, if you put a scale on
that.
That's
correct. This was done, completed, when we went through the actual location of the canopy.
Right. I'm not going to argue with the scale, because I know it's difficult to do with a diagonal perspective, but and it's reasonably close. I just want to make sure that when you come back to the board, that that's where it's really going to be. As a suggestion, because you have moved it in there, and I like that approach better, especially with this the gray roof. If you're going to move it toward the building, then you start to incorporate it as a part of the design of the building. You've left 23 feet. The pad in front of the store is 27 feet or 26 and a half feet. So you're going to be cutting some of that off to allow this 10 foot. Is there some reason why it's not even closer, to make the canopy even closer to the structure itself?
I don't know at this point, other than...
I guess also, because I sense that there may not be consensus, I don't want to give you one sense and you move it within 5 feet of the building and then come back and the rest of the board says, no, we want it all the way to the street.
Yeah. The first site conflict that comes to mind is the parking here in the front.
Mm-hmm.
The closer you get it, you start chewing away at the parking and you don't have travel on access aisles to that.
Yeah, so and I am a frequent customer of that location, and I was there again tonight. That's why I knew it was 27 feet out. So. As planners, we can look at that site and say, yes, this is perfect for parking. You know, the sweep and the radius is just right for every car. But if you went there tonight and you go there almost any time during the day, people don't park where the parking spots are typically. And they certainly weren't tonight. I think as prudent planners, we need to look at the site. Yes, we approve a site with certain parking and parking patterns, but we have to look at it from a common sense point of view. Where are people going to stop? Where's the flow of traffic going to be? touch just on the traffic report a little bit. I'm not sure that any improvement on a 1984 traffic report will give us more insight as to on-site flow there. There are a couple issues. You do have a big tractor-trailer rig that comes in for deliveries. That's maybe the only tractor-trailer rig that you'd have to have a 14.5-foot clearance for the canopy height. Your tanker rig, I don't know what the height of that is, but I guess it typically comes in through the north entrance and sweeps back around, and I guess sits over the downloads into those receptacles, the tanks. I assume that with the present location, those two functions can still happen?
Yes.
Okay.
Let me go back to the height of the canopy again.
Mm-hmm.
If you remember the railroad bridge that went over Broadway before the whole system got rebuilt in South Portland, a photo of a truck stuck under that appeared in the newspaper probably once a year until that got changed. Cumberland Farms is an ideal spot for people who rent rider trucks to stop and fuel up and gas and that type of thing. Those vehicles approach that height as well, so that it is more than just that. So I guess what I'm saying is don't expect a change in the height there. You only have to have one or two canopies ripped off with the fire suppression system at that height to cause real problems. And at this point, the vehicle heights on the road are up to 14 feet, and I would expect Cumberland Farms to maintain that height simply to avoid those types of situations.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Again, I have several other, just a couple other issues to bring up, but I'd like a little discussion from the board so we don't distract or mislead the applicant. Well, what's some consensus from the board as far as moving the canopy closer to the structure itself? Tom? if that's possible.
I guess there's really two approaches I have to the issue. I think one is, the first issue is there a canopy at all? I think that's the first issue that the board needs to address. Assuming that there is, I think that the canopy should, if it's demonstrated that there's no unreasonable impact on the historic building in the background that's mentioned in the town center report, that the canopy should, as I think is appropriate for the town center of Cape Elizabeth, be distinctive and part of the building, not just another, I happen to have gone up Route 4 recently, not just another canopy that I can find on any strip in the state of Maine down the East Coast. It should be appropriate to the site, to the building, and to the use. And how that's determined, I guess, you know, that's part of the planning and design process. I think it's appropriate to say that it doesn't make a lot of sense for someone to be under a canopy pumping gas and then to have to sprint 27 feet to get into the building, and that it's not necessary that canopy that connects the building to the gas canopy be as wide as. It could be narrower, it could align with the building edge and be slightly lower at its peak then because it's not as wide. But I think that's sort of the next level of review. It's a difference between the main part of the house and the L of the house. The L of the house is narrower and it has a lower roof line, and it's more in pedestrian scale than it is in the truck scale.
From the montage, I consider this a useful tool to work with, and if you take a scale rule and you consider the doorway going in about 6'8", then that's a similar distance from the point of perspective. If you were to change the existing location of this gray canopy to what you show on the plan, the whole thing shifts over about 5/8, between 5/8 and 3/4 inch, to represent that 10-foot lane and then a 23-foot pad in front of it. So you see, that sits right in front of, and an issue with this board is this historical building behind there. And the visual path to see it as it's a gateway into this town. I personally think that there's a benefit to moving it toward the building in that getting past this point of viewpoint, you have a widened visual corridor just past, just up the hill as you proceed south.
Yes, it's a dynamic situation.
Part of, right, as it becomes a part of the building, you actually are widening a larger view corridor as you proceed south. The fact that Cumberland Farms likes their golf advertising on a 3-foot plastic band, I think, if my memory serves me correctly, the asphalt roof at a 412 pitch comes to about a 6-foot band visually, as far as from a horizontal perspective, in order to get that pitch. Again, I see that as more acceptable, and even more acceptable as you move it closer to the building. At a minimum, I'd like to see the montage fixed so that it shows where the actual location is. School traffic, we're soon to be looking at a new school plan, and there's existing children, there's a great deal of foot traffic from the school itself that comes to Cumberland Farm. Is there any improvement that can, I guess this is a question to consider in the next 30 days or in time till submission, that can improve the foot traffic for school students on the site to incorporate with a proposed traffic? I'm not sure where that comes from. I look at the sidewalk there, but I'm not sure school children use that sidewalk anyway that goes around the perimeter. I'm just asking to take a look at some on-site, if there's any improvements that can be done for on-site foot traffic. Last question that I have is, where is the sewer line located presently?
I'm not sure at this point.
A recent site plan approval that we had here was that one of those conditions was that upon the failure, the condition of the site plan approval was upon the failure of the existing system that the applicant hooked to town sewer. As one planning board member, I'd want to make sure that that's a condition as well.
We can add that. Okay.
Judy?
Mr. Greer, can you compare to for me, this canopy, which is approximately 20 and a half feet tall, to the height of the roof on the building?
The roof on the building is probably 20 feet to the peak, something like that.
In answer to your request, Mr. Edsel, I certainly would favor moving it closer and have that integrated with the building. I don't know how, if it would be possible to actually attach it, given the offset of the building to the canopy, but some allusion to that with a covered way all to the door. I'm not saying this very articulately, I think would be a real plus. Right now, I certainly favor the shingled roof over the Gulf sign type of roof, but it looks like a sore thumb right now, especially when it's out of balance, when you don't have the overhang on the left. So I'd like to see what you can do to improve that visually.
Okay.
Tom?
Several things. I don't want to get into a substantive issue, but the times that I go to the store, it seems to me one of the most popular parking places is parallel parking in front of the door, running in, making a quick purchase, running out and hopping in the car and driving. I guess I'm concerned that if the fueling stations are within 10 feet, that obviously dedicates that space to fueling. And if someone does come in to do exactly as I just described, there's either a loss of business because someone is unable to get gasoline. I think there's a conflict there that I would like to have you address in terms of why my gut feeling here is that everything's located because of the setbacks. If you could do this differently, you would. In my experience in going to convenience store, there's usually some room between the fueling pumps and either for emergency access or for convenience access. But I think that's a narrative or a presentation issue that needs to be explored further and maybe something that can be discussed and described under a substantive review.
What you're suggesting then is that the canopy be moved away from the building?
No, I'm not. I'm leaving the canopy as a separate issue. The issue is on-site circulation and conflicts between parking, standing parking. And because what you've done here is by placing that fueling island within 10 feet of that curb line, you've eliminated either the ability to parallel park there, which most people do. Realistically, people don't like parking, for some reason, don't like parking in the handicapped areas that you've designated on the plan, maybe because it's already a handicapped space there. And the other spaces that are located in front of the building tend to fill up quickly because, and it's not your fault, it's just people refuse to park reasonably. They tend to straddle lines. So I often see people parallel parking in front of the building because it's a convenient thing to do, and it's the maybe a space that's left over. But I think that's all part of a narrative about site circulation and part of the review process. The other, you have an inside, some inside information on this, I would suppose, is the issue of stormwater quality. You are adding pumps. As I understand, there's no on-site catch basins. There is quite a bit of petroleum product that ends up on the ground, and I think that should be addressed in a narrative form. The plantings, you've shown three. I would favor an additional tree where you've shown it, and I think from your standpoint, Marshall, Seagulls, Ash tend to be very sort of small-scale trees, and they branch lower. They're going to block your view to the store. I think something more of a larger-scale street tree would be appropriate. And the trees that you have now are tend to leaf late and lose their leaves early. They tend to have somewhat of a feathery and open texture, the ash, and I wouldn't have any problem utilizing those and putting in, I would recommend, a 2.5 to 3-inch caliper tree, but that's more of a substantive review. But that's pretty specific. The sidewalk that goes along Scott Dyer Road is shown crossing into your property. I don't know if either as part of the reconfiguration of the intersection or as part of a previous approval, if that was ever cleared up, if there's an easement granted to the town or to the state for that sidewalk.
I don't know if there is an easement. It does do that. It may actually tie into the existing pavement. We may not have shown an access out onto the pavement that actually connected at that point.
Seemed to me that while we're going through this process, that issue ought to be, it could be simply on a deed someplace that we don't know about, but if there is a conflict, we ought to, should know about it at this point. The traffic report is 10 years old. I don't know what the status is of the intersection configuration in terms of, I know that there was a proposal for lights that did not succeed, I guess. But I just want to be sure that as you describe the circulation around the site, I don't disagree with your concept that I feel there's going to be more on-site traffic conflicts and more on-site traffic, perhaps. I don't think that the number of trips on Route 77 are going to suddenly double because you've added more pumps, unless you drop the price of gasoline down to 68.5 or something. But I am particularly, for your information and for ours, I'd like to know if there are any available MDOT layouts that showed how they were going to configure the intersection with the proposed lights, or whether it was just simply relighting.
As far as I'm aware, it never got to that design point.
Okay. The number of handicap spaces, you're showing two. I know the regulations change every other week, but I believe it's one per 25. I don't see the need to have any more than, unless from your marketing standpoint, you feel that two are necessary. It's a convenience store, and part of that is having accessible parking. And I think if there's no need for additional handicap parking, I wouldn't propose it. I don't know how successfully the ramp that's there now works, but I believe there is a paved ramp up through the sidewalk. And unless there's some code issue with that, I wouldn't expect that you would have to tear up as much pavement as you're showing here and repave that. As long as you're meeting standards for handicap parking and the space is usable, I see people coming in this intersection, getting up on that ramp and heading into the side of the building. I just don't do any more than you have to in that situation. Vehicle height, would you just simply describe the vehicle type, if it's a fixed body, rented rider truck, give us a height so that we have something to judge the height of the canopy against. I think the one thing that tends to tear up canopies more than anything else is the RV world, that they may have all of their belongings stacked on top of something and they cream it underneath one of these. But if you give us some vehicle references, I don't think it needs to be as high as the highest interstate bridge in the state of Maine that may have been built last year that supposedly is going to take nuclear warheads underneath it or whatever. And lastly, the curb height against the existing concrete area there where the plant is shown on the plan, that tends to be somewhat of an uncomfortable height. And if you just confirm when you do your grading plan what that is, and particularly where it's a convenience store, it seems as though the grade falls away fairly quickly there. It must be about eight inch curb height.
Yeah, I think we've reduced that to 6. We've redone some of the paving back around in this area. Okay. To do that.
And I do appreciate the photo montages. It's particularly helpful, and I know it's something people are doing more of, and it's helpful. I just would encourage that I would favor canopy number 1. I know you guys have CAD. I would encourage that you may employ CAD to do some three-dimensional, even if it's only an axonometric view. The concern I have with the view that you've shown is I believe the canopy is going to be, at least from the plan, it appears that the canopy is perpendicular to the store. And I know perspectives can be deceiving, but it would seem to me that the canopy would be rotating more toward the viewer on the left side, and you'd see the gable end of the canopy. And particularly where the canopy is 14 feet high, I would expect that in 3 dimensions we'd see quite a bit of the underbody, so to speak, of the canopy, including the lights. And perhaps a way of dealing with that, I'll make a suggestion, if you go out and photograph something of a similar distance and a similar grade change, that may be asking quite a bit. That may give you something that you could lay in more easily or use a computer to tie it in. I think you've gone through the first step, but I'd look for another. This is going to be a very important change to the town center, and I'd like to have as accurate a graphic representation of it as possible to make decisions about where it is, how big it is, and the impact that it has on the town center. And lastly, I guess I agree with the earlier comment. I think it's too bad that you're against the setback restriction. You end up with a canopy that is designed because of a setback rather than because of balance and all the other good design principles and functional needs of covering the outside fueling aisle. But I don't, unless you eliminate an aisle or something happens, perhaps with the 40-foot setback, you could do something. But it don't look right, to tell you the truth. But I think that's the next level of review. That's okay. It.
Good. Mark?
There's a comment that I would like to raise in direct relation to Mr. Emery's concern about the view of underside of canopy, and that would be if I do not sense a strong, compelling reason to connect the canopy directly to the store. Maybe some, and my outlook on that would simply be right now there are significant sort of view. There's a significant sort of view corridor, if you will, in between the canopy and the store that looks at Thomas Memorial Library, and the intrusion of a low element, particularly one brightly lit underneath, would cut off even more of that view as you approach the town center. So I would think twice, I would especially look to see some sort of three-dimensional representation of the effect that would give if that seemed to be something desirable from your vantage point.
Okay.
I'm a little concerned, because I think Mark's comment was not necessarily contradictory, but with some talk about moving it closer, and some, and Mark's comment about moving it away from the building further.
No, I think his comment was, if I correct here, is connecting the canopy to the store, and that, putting that lower element in there, whether that's needed or not.
I see, okay.
Whether that blocks the view.
Okay, I see. I guess I concur. My original comment about moving it in, number one, that this doesn't represent where the existing plan. Number two is that it stands right now that the first pump's 33 feet from the door. Is there a reason for that? I guess, you know, what I guess is, you hear us talking, we're looking for, that's a real key piece to us, and it stems from our town center plan. I assume that you've read part of that, and,
yes.
And I think we'll be looking very closely to see if it significantly adheres to specifically town center vision and goals versus create a town center zone. Enhance visual gateways, entrances, and edges to the town center, such as the Tarbox Triangle, and a key visual corridor that we see of Thomas Memorial Library Building, which is listed as a historical building. Whatever the optimum location of that can be, is to distract from that as little as possible, I think is what we're looking for. I also heard talk about concern for traffic flow, you know, concerns about the health safety issues dealing with traffic flow on site, concerns about landscaping, some discussion about that. One comment I didn't make is that, and I think Tom covered it pretty well, the landscape architect, that we don't want to contradict what we're saying about the canopy with what we say about planting more trees. And, you know, if we're going to not cover that visual corridor with a canopy, we certainly don't want to cover that same visual corridor with trees, but trees that are good street trees that provide that vision through there. I guess, turn it back to you, with other questions we would like to proceed, and hopefully you'll be back next month with a public hearing. Questions you have of us is to make it more clear to you.
No, I think we have a pretty good idea what the board is looking for. My impression here is that when we leave here, we will be revising the canopy design, location, that type of thing, to better accommodate some of the comments. Whether we can make the significant changes to the plan that maybe some of the board members are looking for, I have serious concerns with those. I'm not sure that we're going to be able to do those, but I think most of the items, I think we can address fairly easily.
Two things. One that was the height of the canopy, and I think Tom's point was, you know, if you're saying it's got to be 14 and a half feet, give us some reference points, you know, whether it's a ride a truck 13 and a half feet, or is it 12 feet, or what's the typical RV, you know, that would pull in here anyway, that would go to Crescent Beach and so forth. What's a typical height with an air conditioner on top and that type of thing? So we have some visual reference, I think, to that. Mark, did you have another question?
Yes, I was wondering, this is maybe most appropriately for Maureen, that in determining setbacks, even a cantilevered canopy and not where the structure touches the ground is what's used. It seems particularly ironic here that we're considering within a few months changing to a 35-foot maximum setback in the town center and a 25-foot minimum.
The one consolation I can give you is up until June of last year, the setback was larger than it is right now. So it's moving at least in the same direction. In terms of measurement, I was just looking for the definition of how to measure setback. In the ordinance, it's defined as the shortest distance from a building to the nearest lot line or sideline of a street right-of-way. So, you know, whether or not it has a supporting structure, you measure from you don't measure cantilevered, you know, if someone had a bay window, you wouldn't measure from the bay window unless it had a foundation underneath the bay.
Okay. Judy?
Yes, I want to repeat the various concerns I have with the canopy, and I think some of them are conflicting, so I might encourage the applicant to come back with maybe a couple of plans, since I think there might even be some disagreement on the board at this point. I am concerned with the total height of the canopy, even if it is only half a foot higher than the building itself, it might look funny, to put it mildly. And given the fact that you are, at this point, proposing to leave the outermost pumps without a canopy, I wonder if Cumberland Farms would consider dropping the proposed canopy height and assuming that somehow you'd be directing U-Hauls to the outer pumps. Whether that's done elsewhere, whether it's successful, you mentioned having canopies ripped away, Cumberland Farms must have some anecdotal evidence to refer back to and say why and when that happens, when the canopies are ripped away. I still am skeptical about having cars stacked up at the closer pumps, assuming you have one car at the forward pump, one car at the rear pump, assuming they're heading toward Scott Dyer, for instance, they came in that way. And perhaps one behind, how easy it would be to get out of parking space in particular, and if someone is sandwiched in, if you can actually maneuver out of there and get by, or if, because it's a 10-foot width to the curb, if everyone is always stuck, and what happens when you've got cars coming in at different angles. I'd like some evidence that, in fact, that is a standard setup from, you know, pump curb to sidewalk curb, and that it does work. When I say I have conflicting views, I'd hate to see you pull a canopy further out from where you're proposing it, but I also would like to see it workable. And I don't know if you could give us a couple of examples of the visual and how well the circulation would work. It would be nice to actually show the setbacks on the plan, so when we're talking about the 50-foot or the 40-foot, whatever it is.
Possession.
Okay, we see that. And a last question for either you or Maureen. We talked about getting the original conditions of approval. Did anyone find those?
I think you did some research on those.
Cumberland Farms keeps finding pieces of the file, and I keep getting new pieces, but I have not seen, I'm not sure I've seen those conditions of approval.
And we don't have them here to your knowledge?
I don't remember if there was anything of any significance. I will check again and make a copy of that page of the minutes for the board.
Okay. I'd like to just a last point, try to make sure there's some consensus that's communicated to you. You've proposed or you've shown two different types. I just assume that the board prefers one over the other. I've heard two board members say that they prefer the canopy number one, the gray asphalt. I do as well, so that makes a third. It's just, I can see the heads nod, so there's definitely a preference for at least a design that is more, blends better with the existing building. Yes?
Can I just speak to one point, which is the canopy issue itself? I am very concerned about the fact that the canopy height be dropped, because what you have is you have customers coming into these sites every day, and they assume that a canopy is a canopy, which is a normal height, which is normally about 14.6. They drive under them every single day. They gas up their vehicles. If you drop a canopy down to, say, 13 feet, and you've got a customer coming in, as many signs as you put up that say, don't do that, they do it. And before you know it, they're driving into the canopy, and there's a lot of damage from an operation like that. We have stores that have mansards on the front of them that are approximately about 12 feet off the ground. I probably have $5,000 to $7,000 worth of damage in the stores in Maine on a yearly basis from people just backing into the canopies, just trying to back up to the store. So it's a very severe problem in a lot of cases. And taking that from a standard height down, it'll be a safety hazard to a lot of people. And when that starts dropping down off the canopy onto customers underneath it, very concerned about that fact, that if you try to negotiate that height, it's going to become a problem down the road. And there will be some people hurt with things dropping off, because those are canopies that are put together, and if things start dropping off from somebody hitting it, it'll become a problem. It has to be a standard height. That's a federal guideline type of thing. And the other thing just to address is we have an emergency response plan at Cumberland Farms, and as per as petroleum spillage is concerned, each new gasoline island as it goes in, it has a trough that has to be ingrooved around the entire perimeter of the property. That is the gasoline island.
that has to hold so much gasoline. Anything over 5 gallons in the state of Maine is a reportable spill. Anything under 5 gallons is immediately cleaned up. So all of the gasoline is retained right on the top of that pad. That is one of the nice things about the new pads that are being put in. Protection from spills is a lot better than what it is now. You've got a pad that's 20, 25 years old right now from the existing gas station that was there before. Whatever enhancements you're going to get out of this is better fire protection, better petroleum protection, and a much improved system that is going to be much better for the customer. So in all ways, the town will have something that's a lot better than what's out there right now.
Thank you. Anything else?
Will there be details of the pad included?
There can be. We can have details of the pad included.
The issue of storm increase runoff is not an issue to the town engineer, but the real concern in this community in greater Portland is pollution of Casco Bay. And I know it's a long trip to Casco Bay, but it's a little closer here than it is in some places. And I'd like to just have that addressed for the record.
Okay. Anything else? Comments?
I'd like to make one general comment. It's not a specific statement, but it's an observation. We really are faced with a two-edged sword here. You as the applicant, particularly as an applicant that has hundreds of thousands of outlets and who has to, in many cases, go to every community, it's clearly understood that the minute you bend over backwards for one community, you're exposing yourself as a precedent for any other community that wants to massage and twist and change your standard operating procedures. Let's use the Freeport McDonald's as a good example. They went into Freeport kicking, screaming, and at least from what I read in the press, not wanting to do anything particular with that with the house that was renovated. I guess the other way to look at this is that Cape Elizabeth is a unique community. It's not as architecturally unique as many other Maine communities are and many other New England communities. I see this as an opportunity to take a unique situation. I think the situation is more unique than the community is that you're at the town center. We've just developed a town center plan. And I think it's an opportunity where I can see a president of a corporation bringing in people from other businesses and proudly displaying on a wall, this is what we did in a community that has a reputation of being particularly thorough in its review process. And this is a way in which we work closely with that community and develop something that we are quite proud of and now can use as an alternative. I don't know how long it took you to agree to the pitched roof canopy, but I'm sure that's quite a change from the typical flat roof. But that's the way in which I would like to go through this process, is an understanding that this is a unique situation, but I don't think it has a sole application in Maine or in your business area.
I think that's a good comment, that it's an opportunity for Cumberland Farms to please the town, that you're a welcome part of our big downtown, and we are thorough in our review, but it's also an opportunity for Cumberland Farms to stand out, and I certainly like to look at it from that perspective. Do I hear a motion?
Mr.
Yes.
Chairman?
Judy.
Propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Cumberland Farms for site plan review of the canopy addition be tabled to the regular March 15th, 1994 meeting.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Been moved and second. Any further discussion?
Just one question.
Judy?
Not being an architect or trained like some of you folks are, would anyone find it useful to go out to the site with balloons or anything showing the heights of canopies? I mean, I know that's done. I
think you can look across the street, and I think you can see the height of the canopy. Those are standard canopies.
Except
you've proved that before.
For me, Mr. Greer, that is set back. Jonesy's, I mean, it's a real gas station.
That's closer to the right-of-way than what we're proposing.
I guess because of the building right on the corner there, I'm not going to argue whether it literally does not stand out or it doesn't seem as prominent to me as this, because you have this massive pavement right on the corner. And if no one else wants to do it, that's fine with me, but I can't really envision what it's going to look like. And perhaps Mr. Zemre's suggestion of having the actual canopy positioned correctly on the photo montage would be very helpful, and the correct position. Just something I threw out before we vote.
I'll say we did that in a limited way at the Viking Nursing Home when we're concerned about roof heights and where the facade would be and so forth. At a sidewalk, they provided us, it was not very fancy, it was just some 2x4s tacked together that were the right height, and it was painted red on top, I think, and there was a balloon set there that would be the height of something, I can't remember, there was a weather vane on top of the building or something. I neglected to ask if the board wants a sidewalk. I guess I assumed everybody was familiar with the site, and I apologize for that. We have a motion before us, but I certainly don't mind including this in some discussion.
I guess I'd find a site more walk more valuable after the next meeting.
Any other comment? I'm looking for consensus or
none.
No requirement for a site walk? Okay.
Walk at many times.
I guess unless we're more consensus, I think the point is, you know, if the photo montage doesn't give you a good sense, as Tom was looking to have it enhanced a little bit, then perhaps we'll have to go on site. But it is a possibility we've done it before.
Mr. Chairman, before this proceeding is closed, I knew we'd have to we'd have the Jonesy's canopy. I'll use a phrase: thrust down our throat. You're not the only person in town that is able to have a canopy or would be looking to come before the board for canopy. Part of the approval process of that canopy was with the zoning board, and it was essentially in our laps as a canopy when it arrived in front of us. There had been a conditional approval granted by the zoning board. Because there's one canopy in town, because it happens to be flat, that was also done before there was a town center report, and part of the town center report was in response to that. So I think we have to look at this as starting anew and going along with my other comments. The fact that there's one across the street really has, if it has anything to do with it, with this application at all, I think it serves as an inspiration to be even more creative on this site. Mm.
I don't get me wrong, Cumberland Farms is certainly willing to work with you. We're coming back with a different canopy design and different location and trying to meet those requirements. We aren't suggesting that they have a flat canopy and we should have one as well. We're certainly giving the board the option, and I throw it out as there is a canopy in town. If you want to see the height of it, there is already a condition on that one that was for the lighting levels, and my understanding is that they've already reduced them. It was a very simple procedure to go out and do that, so that there is some history with that, and that I think we can utilize that. We would like to reach an end to this and get a vote on it. Your suggestion that even after the public hearing that you're already anticipating additional meetings, I find of a concern. We would like to be treated fairly as an applicant, and the information that we've provided, and I think the level of detail that will be provided for the public hearing, we're looking for a vote on the project, and I'd like to keep that in mind as well.
I think myself as chair, or whoever is sitting in the chair position at that time, you know, that's the duty to make sure that we continue to focus on that, that we treat you fairly and at a level of reasonableness. All things considered, just a short mention of the other canopy and so forth. I think it's a good comment to say that, you know, there are some comparisons that we make as in lieu of taking a site walk. A comment was made about the underview of lighting. I mean, the angle looking up under that canopy is going to be fairly similar as to looking up under the canopy on your side of the road. Sizes and so forth. I think the comment of that canopy or that site plan would not be handled the same today as it was when it was handled. I was sat and very much involved in that as well. And I think the key issue for this planning board member is that there was no town center plan in place. I wish there were, and I know it would be handled differently today. But, Judy,
just a quick request. to help me have some understanding of the lighting that's proposed, if perhaps whatever photometric data that was submitted as part of Jonesy's could be brought forward and we can compare, and if that was found to be too bright and we could look at this and see this is brighter still, that would be very straightforward to reduce the lighting now instead of at some later date.
I think that's a good comment.
That's available, we'd certainly like to take a look at
it. Maybe part of the approval originally.
The only reason, I don't intend to drag this out any longer than necessary. I do think it needs close scrutiny, and you certainly are an existing use. This is a permitted use within the zone. There are setbacks. All of that's set forth, and there's absolutely no argument about that from my perspective. The reason that I've suggested another meeting after the next meeting is that this meeting deals with issues of completeness, and there's no substantial substantive review of the application at this time. I don't know that there's a lot of value, and perhaps there is, of going out and placing balloons at the corner of the canopy as you've now proposed. I think what I've heard tonight is that many people aren't comfortable with the design of it, the depiction of it on the perspective. And I think once we see the revised perspective, then I would feel I, at that point, could make a decision as to whether or I'd feel better informed as to whether or not it's necessary to go out and place balloons to mark the corners of the canopy. Quite honestly, as having been on both sides of this table, every time that a planning board requests going out and either staking a building or marking corners or looking at heights, it's been nothing but informative from the standpoint of an applicant, that things are always different on the ground. Staked out, they're either bigger or smaller, or they have different impact implications in what you may think on paper, or we may think on paper, or what the photograph may consider. So I'm leaving that open as a possibility. You may convince us with a perspective and with the, I think this is a unique situation. It's a design review, it's a town center, and it's somewhat of an iterative process. It's not a black and white issue, at least from my standpoint. But I'm not here to say that, we recognize that you need to be treated fairly as an applicant and that we have an ordinance that we need to look at and use that as a basis for our decision making.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
To follow up Tom's comments, what he's essentially told the applicant here is that we ought to have a site walk. And I guess we would like to have that scheduled prior to the public hearing so the board can get that feel for the site, how big the canopy is, where it's located, and that type of thing. So I guess from the applicant's point of view, if that could be arranged, we would appreciate it. I think there is going to be those concerns of view corridors, where is it, and that type of thing. To stand here and present them on boards, I don't think is going to give all of the board members the feel maybe that they need to have. Mm-hmm. Is that a possibility? Can we have a sidewalk prior to the public hearing?
I'll go around the crew one more time to see if with that plea that would want to take a sidewalk that Judy was in favor of before. Tom?
I think the primary value of, I think the advantage you have is that we're all very familiar with the site, but I think the real benefit that can be gained from a sidewalk is if the corners of the canopy are marked and that you fly balloons at the proposed height of the canopy. I think that'd be very helpful, and hopefully we'll have a calm day to do that on.
We've done that before.
Yeah, that's fine. We have no problem doing that.
Did an antenna a few years ago up on a mountain.
Yeah, that's not a problem.
It didn't work because it was a windy day, and it came down to about 25 feet anyway.
We would like to have it scheduled, I'm going to say, closer to the public hearing to give us the opportunity to revise some of the layout, maybe present the layout that you'll see at the public hearing.
Okay.
Address some of the other comments.
Yeah, I think that's appropriate, and I guess I'm going to urge the board to do that.
Hope it could be after vacation week, if at all possible.
Okay.
I don't know what the deadline is morning for.
Deadline would be April, March?
It's February 25th, so last Friday of this month. So it is the end of vacation week, is it?
The last day of submission would be the 25th of February, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. That's the last Friday of February.
Okay, mm-hmm. It is. We're currently...
15th.
10 days away from here. It would have to be this weekend.
Or, I guess, you folks don't usually
Mr. Chairman,
in the evening.
We just soon have the site walk, even after the latest submission, just to give the board a feel.
Okay.
I don't anticipate... What I'm hoping to get from it is that we'll make the submission on the 25th. You'll have a chance to see the revised layout.
You'll have.
We'll get comments back from that. If there are minor things that can be changed, they can be changed as conditions of approval, that type of thing.
Then that would need to be the weekend before a planning board meeting.
Which would either be the weekend of March 5th or March 12th, either one.
We don't get our materials, though, until like the 10th or 11th.
I think the issue is that's narrowing it down a great deal. I think they're willing to, whether we have the materials on hand or not, they're there with a physical representation. This is what it's going to be. They probably will have something on site. Here's a picture of what you will see when you get your packet. There's the balloons, here's the height, this and that.
Yes.
A preference for either the weekend of the 5th or the 12th? Going once, going twice?
Either one.
A preference?
Yep.
Let's make it the 5th, which is a Saturday morning. Time? What time's good? 8:30? 9?
9 o'clock.
9 o'clock? 9 o'clock, March 5th?
Great.
We will be there.
Thank you very much. We appreciate that.
Okay. Oops, we were in the middle of discussion. Any further discussion on the motion for us? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, which was to table until the next meeting, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's tabled.
Thank you very much.
See you on the 5th. Thank you. The next order of business, and we are about an hour behind schedule, under other business, sewer ordinance amendments, request from the town council recommend amendments to the zoning board, zoning ordinance with shifts responsibility for sewer appeals to the Board of Zoning Appeals, zoning amendment, section 19-4-9. I'd ask Maureen to summarize this quickly and tell us why this is before us.
The town council recently approved a restructuring of boards and commissions within the town, and one of the results of that was that the Board of Sewer Appeals has been shifted from a appeals board to more of a policy-making board. They were getting less than one appeal a year, and therefore were relatively inexperienced with the legalities of granting an appeal. So the recommendation was to make the Sewer Appeals Board a policy board and to refer any appeals to the zoning board, which is well practiced at granting those appeals and with the structure of it. What you have before you is a set of amendments which have been drafted by the town attorney. The council was on the verge of adopting them when it was noted that under our zoning ordinance, everything has to be referred to the planning board first. I'd like to point out that under the technical amendments, which took effect on the 12th of this month, the board has the option to hold a public hearing. Previously, you were required to hold a public hearing. Now you may choose on whether or not you hold a public hearing on amendments to the zoning ordinance. Therefore, what you need to discuss is whether you want to hold a public hearing or not, and or whether you want to just recommend these back to the council as drafted or as amended.
Any questions? Does the planning board choose to have a public hearing? I said, do you choose? Okay, it's obvious that we do not choose to have a public hearing. Any discussion on the amendments? Do I hear a motion? Mark?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to propose the following motion.
Thank you, Mark.
Be it ordered that, based on the information presented, the Planning Board recommends the attached sewer appeal amendments to the Town Council.
It's been moved. Do I hear it seconded?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Do I hear any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it is a unanimous vote and approval. Thank you. The last item of business, Planning Board goals, a recommendation to the Town Council Planning Board goals for this year. I drafted these up from our discussion at the last meeting. I just asked Maureen to present these here tonight so you could go down through them and see if there's any changes before I submit them to the Town Council or to the Town Manager. Any, Judy?
I just have a general question. Is this at all realistic for the next year, given the pace we seem to work at?
It's aggressive, but not much different than what we typically see, anywhere from 4 to 6 goals set.
Do we typically meet the goals we set, then?
No. Historically, fall short.
Lead to depression and despair.
But we like to torture ourselves.
We always need to set those high goals.
Otherwise, we'd stop short, you know, we'd stop sometime in December or something like that.
Just to point out to the board, number one, you've got, you're more than two-thirds done. Number six is an ongoing issue. Number five is really out of your hands until another committee completes its work. So you really have only three new items on here. And those could almost be, I mean, they may be grouped together.
One comment. On item number two, I think it's important in that sentence that follows to make mention of the comprehensive plan in conjunction with and supplemental to. I guess I would put the comprehensive plan, then the sewer policy proposals.
Sounds good.
Okay. I didn't understand. No, that's fine. The comp plan and...
And
then scratch down here, short-term comp plan review. Combined, no, that's right. That's fine. Mm-hmm. Good. Anything else? I mean, that's the type of thing I was looking for before we finish this off and send it out. This requires no motion. I will simply submit that as redrafted. Any other business to become before the planning board?
The
Judy?
April meeting.
The April meeting.
That would be one of them.
This is where I propose that we have a different meeting date. But,
yeah.
Oh, this is the one I scribbled on, isn't it?
It's okay.
Do we have to take a vote to change the meeting date?
No.
Okay. Proposing that we change the meeting date in April to the 25th. And for the life of me, I can't remember why.
The week after vacation?
I'm not going to be here. Mm-hmm.
She's not going. Maureen's not going to be here.
I won't be here.
On the 19th. That's true.
Is that on Tuesday?
It's a Monday. No, we made sure that you didn't have a conflict with the zoning board, Alice.
Changes the submission date in May to the 4th. I was thinking there's another key date. Is that acceptable to everybody? That's all I have to do. Yeah.
And that's a Monday?
Just a strange question.
Sure.
And maybe it has to do with Maureen's availability to look at the submissions. Are we, in fact, moving the date? I hate to use forwards or backwards. Is it later in the month than it normally would be?
If you agree to the April 25th meeting, that's usually have your meeting on a Tuesday, the third Tuesday. You're moving your meeting to the fourth Monday of the month.
Oh,
so you're moving your meeting forward into the year, which then gives anyone who's going to the April meeting 4 days to get their submission in for the May meeting. Because the submission deadline for the May meeting would be April 29th. So it's instead of requiring the April 29th, you're giving them another week or so. You're giving them